Friends, very good evening to all of you. I welcome you all to one of the most important memorial lectures which we keep awaiting for the year, S. Vaidyanath Iyer and Memorial Lecture. We are very, very fortunate and blessed to have Honorable Justice V. Ramasubramanian ji, Supreme Court of India, who has given the kind consent to deliver the memorial lecture today. So before we take things forward, I request all of you to rise for ICA motto song.
यैष सुप्तेषु जाग्रति कामं 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 कामपुरुषो पुरुषो निर्मिमाणः तदेव शुक्रं तदेव शुक्रद ब्रह्मा तदेवामृतमुच्यते तस्मिन् लोकः अस्मिन् लोकः शतः सर्वे तदूना चरितश्च नात्यतीतश्च
Friends, as our institute motto song says, Ya Esha Sukteshu Jagrati, today's memorial lecture on S. Vaidyanath Iyer ji, who was a man who was known for his integrity and ethical values. In fact, he was a forerunner in the income tax practice during those days and very, very upright person who could kind of had the guts to tell anything to anybody. So today we are very, very fortunate to have a memorial lecture, the annual memorial lecture. And he was the institute's president during the year 1957-58 and 58-59 up to 5th February 1959. In fact, that was the third council and the fourth council of ICAI. And from his offices, we are blessed that there were three past presidents who had hailed from his office. First one being S. Vaidyanathan Iyer ji himself, second one being C. Rameshwar Thakur ji, third CAVJ Rajaraman ji, who was the past president in the year 1980-81. In fact, there were very, very important decisions which took when he was the president, like the Section 5(3) of the CA Act was amended, where people who are under employment, who are not holding COP, were also allowed to become fellow members then. That happened for the first time. The scheme was approved for the constituting an annual prize in the form of a shield for the best presented accounts, which is even continuing today, to see that the award to the best president accounts is given in ICA. And during his term, the administration of students association was transferred to the regional council from the coaching board. In initial days, we had coaching board that got transferred to the regional council. The Landon committee was authorized to write to the regional councils to send recommendations regarding the construction of buildings or the purchase of the buildings in their regions to house the office of the regional councils. Today we have this five regional councils which are kind of benefited out of that decision. The article and audit clerks were allowed to receive as part of their practical training in industrial houses. Today, of the 3 years, you can do 1 to 2 years of industrial training, which is even kind of continuing today, exists from the year 1956-57. In fact, we could not know much because of the time gap, because he was the president in the 1956-57. Maybe our beloved Central Council member, C. Rajendra Kumar sir, will throw some words on him. So before we take things forward, I will request C. Rajendra Kumar sir to share his thoughts with all of us.
Esteemed Chairman of the region, C. Dungarchand Jain, Most Honorable Justice V. Ramasubramanian sir, dear CA Abhishek, the Secretary of SIRC, and all other esteemed members who have gathered in front of their laptops, iPads, and mobile phones to hear the legal luminary, Honorable Justice V. Ramasubramanian. Good evening to all of you. As all of you are aware, yesterday there was a change in guard in our institute. CA Nihar Jambusaria, a member in industry, became the president of ICAI, and CA Debashish Mitra, a member in practice from Kolkata, assumed the office as the vice president, having got elected yesterday. CA Nihar Jambusaria, till about being elected as vice president, was in industry. Later on, he resigned and he is full time now the president, and was also the vice president of ICAI. Esteemed members, this new guard took charge yesterday, and I'm happy to inform you all that the things were very smooth, and we had a full, almost members of the council attending, and your council will be second to none in discharging the responsibilities cast by the statute to the Parliament of India. CA Dungarchand Jain referred to Vaidyanath Iyer's Lives and Times. I would like to mention to all of you that he was also the only president of the ICAI who died in office. He was the only president of ICAI who passed away while in office. And the council recorded its sincere gratitude and appreciation for the monumental work done by S. Vaidyanath Iyer by instituting the only fund of ICAI to have been instituted in the name of any past president or member also, if we can put it. Never before, never after, we have any fund in the name of any member which is officially instituted by the Council of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. Such was the stature, such was the height of a great person like S. Vaidyanath Iyer. In fact, many of you may not be aware that coming from the southern region, he ruled Delhi's intellectual world. He ensured that the intellectual expertise of South Indians spreads far and wide. And the council's decision that the fund created in the name of S. Vaidyanath Iyer be utilized for the purposes of memorial lectures, and the process goes on and on and on. Many, many intellectual luminaries have addressed the regional councils. In fact, all the regional councils, it is compulsory for them to hold the Vaidyanath Iyer Memorial Lecture every year. It is compulsory. So each year we have luminaries and personalities coming and delivering this lecture. We have here today Honorable Justice V. Ramasubramanian. Like all of you, I am also very, very eager to hear him and also learn from what he would like to say on professional ethics. In fact, with bated breath, I'm sitting before all of you to listen to Honorable Justice. Thank you, Chairman, sir, for this wonderful opportunity. And we from the Members and Student Services Directorate, who contribute and who conduct this lecture, are happy that we have brought in one more jewel in the crown of ICAI today. Thank you very much. Back to you.
Thank you so much, RK sir. In fact, this is the first meeting where ICAI announced its awards for the region and the branches. And I must tell all the members and students that SARC bagged the first prize after a span of 10 years. And along with ICAI, there were 13 such awards out of total 29 awards. I take this opportunity to thank each and every member and student for their kind cooperation during the year, without which it would not have been possible. It's a proud moment for each member of SARC.
Thank you, Chairman, sir. Congratulations. You must also mention that the last award was bagged by me.
Yes.
And it is now you. Thank you.
Shanmugasundaram ji, and then you, sir, actually. So it's third in succession, actually. So thank you so much. And before I request Abhishek to formally introduce our guest and the speaker, I would like to share certain things about him, which I came to know. That he's been part of, as Rajendra Kumar sir just said before the program, he is part of a lot of landmark judgments, including few on income tax, actually. And one good thing about Justice V. Ramasubramanian ji is he does not waste even the smallest time. I learned that whenever during his travel, say from he's going to X place to Y place, he will see to it that his iPad is always on and there are some kind of updations which keep happening. And the third very important thing, he kind of talks more about Kamba Narayana, Kamba Ramana. So you know where this professional ethics actually come from. So the base is very strong, and probably we are going to have an excellent lecture on professional ethics today. Abhishek, we can go ahead with the formal introduction of the speaker.
Thank you very much. Very warm good afternoon to all the participants present here. Chairman of SIRC, C.A. Dungarchand Jain, the beloved Central Council member, C.A. Rajendra Kumar, and of course, the chief guest of the day, the illustrious Honorable Justice V. Ramasubramaniam, sir. It's a pleasure and privilege for me to introduce the chief guest today for multiple reasons. The very obvious reasons have already been highlighted by the chairman and our Central Council member, sir, that he is such an illustrious legal luminary. But more importantly, when I convocated as a chartered accountant, I had the privilege of receiving my convocation certificate from the hands of Justice V. Ramasubramaniam, sir. At the time, he was in Madras. So I had the privilege of collecting it from his hands. So to introduce him is, of course, it feels like a huge opportunity for me to do the same. So I must start off with, he is, of course, a lawyer, and he was born in 1958. He completed his LLB from Madras Law College and joined the bar in 1983 before he was elevated to the bench. He practiced for almost 23 years before this elevation, including before the Madras High Court, Central and State Administrative Tribunals, and City and Small Cases Court, State Consumer Commission, and District Consumer Forum as well. Although his areas of practice were diverse, he specialized in service matters. He was appointed as additional judge of Madras High Court in July 2006, and he went on to become a permanent judge in November 2009, and stayed and served in the Madras High Court till 2016, before subsequently moving to the High Court of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. And then after it was bifurcated, he of course was in the High Court of Telangana, and then later on took charge in 2019 as Chief Justice of the Himachal Pradesh High Court. His subject matter expertise in service law appears to have influenced all of his work as a judge. A significant number of cases, I think statistics show that more than 25% of his decisions are in service law. But I must say, his experience, his expertise does not restrict to that. As the chairman very rightly pointed out, he has authored substantial number of judgments in civil, education, and as a chartered accountant, excise and direct taxation law, of course, that is close to our heart. He is much like his brother, Judge Ravindra Bhatt. He has also given some notable judgments in the field of intellectual property rights, and the most popular one being Consum Info Private Limited versus Google India, where he denied an interim injunction against Google for its keyword suggestions tool. And he is going to continue to serve in the Supreme Court till 2023, where he is delivering, I think, on a daily basis, notable judgments that we are going to be using in our future life. In fact, I must definitely add a personal point here. He is a very close friend of my father, and he was his senior in Vivekananda College. And my father remarked, when I just told him just before the meeting started, he started reminiscing stories about V. Ramasubramaniam, sir. And the most important thing that he told me was he's a consistent academician and someone who's a winner of prizes regularly. That at the time, the principal of Vivekananda College, I think Mr. Venkata Subramaniam, he had said, we need to build more shelves and trophy cabinets just to accommodate the prizes won by Honorable Justice V. Ramasubramaniam, sir. So he is a person who has been consistently winning awards and delivering excellent lectures right from the time when he was in college. So he's continuing to do this by giving us the most notable judgments that we are following in the country, and we will continue to follow. So this is only a brief introduction about our chief guest. It's a huge privilege to have you with us here today, sir, and a personal privilege for me to introduce you. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation to be here today. We are really looking forward to your address.
Thank you. Can begin? Thank you.
Sir, over to you, sir, please.
Dear Chairman and other office bearers of SIRC of ICAI, dear members of the Institute, dear students, if there are any. Someone said, if you want to create history, do something worth writing about, or write something worth reading about. Sri Vaidyanath Iyer belonged to the genre of persons who did something worth remembering about. As the president of the Institute during the period 1957-58, and 1958-59 up to his untimely demise, he carved a niche for himself, and this is why this memorial lecture is organized for the past more than 50 years. When I saw the list of persons who have delivered Sri Vaidyanath Iyer Memorial Lecture, I was surprised to find that other than Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer, no other judge has ever been invited to deliver Mr. Vaidyanath Iyer Memorial Lecture. Of course, there were certain legal luminaries like M.K. Nambiar, Sri K. Parasaran, and Sri Arvind Datta who have delivered this memorial lecture. But no judge other than Justice Krishna Iyer has ever been invited to deliver this lecture. I am the second judge. It is always a pleasure talking to chartered accountants. Since your profession and the legal profession have many things in common, I always used to say that while chartered accountants deal with letters, while lawyers deal with letters, chartered accountants deal with numbers. While lawyers deal with facts, chartered accountants deal with figures. While you audit past performance and the budget for the future, we attempt to remove the injustices of the past future. While you deal with files, we deal with lives. While you deal with assets and liabilities, we deal with rights and liabilities. While you are concerned about profits and losses, we are concerned about victories and losses. While your focus is more on the fiscal aspect of life, our focus is expected to be on the philosophical aspect of life. More than all that, you help create wealth for your clients the right way or the wrong way. And the lawyers protect that wealth for the clients, again, the right way or the wrong way. So your profession and the legal profession have many things in common. When we talk about ethics with reference to your profession, I think we must begin the discourse from Sri Aurobindo, who suggested the emblem and motto of your institute way back in 1949. When the institute was established, Sri Aurobindo chose the emblem of Garuda, the mythological eagle, as its emblem, and a verse from the Kathopanishad as its motto. You just heard the song, Yayeshu Supteshu Jagrati. It means, he who keeps awake and does not sleep. Kathopanishad gave this as an attribute of the Brahman, the ultimate. But the Bhagavatam, which is one of the 18 Puranas, gives it as an attribute of the Kalapurusha, namely time. There is a shloka in Srimad Bhagavatam where Vidura tells Dhritarashtra in Stri Parva of Mahabharata. What he says is, Kalaha pachati bhutani, kalaha samharate prajaha, kalaha supteshu jagrati. You recite yayeshu supteshu jagrati. Vidura said, kalaha supteshu jagrati, kalohi duratikramaha. The meaning of this verse is, time digests all that have materialized. Time kills or takes back all that is born. Time is awake when everything is asleep. Time cannot be defeated or won over. This is the meaning of that verse. Sri Aurobindo chose this motto perhaps to drive home the point that the chartered accountants should have an unquenchable thirst for knowledge and perfection and should always be alert. Only those who are awake when others are asleep may acquire supreme knowledge and attain perfection. Again, the desire to soar to great heights, even while it soars higher and higher in the sky, the eagle spots its little prey and keeps its vigil. Eagle symbolizes both micro and macro management, which is what is required of a chartered accountant. And this is the reason why Aurobindo chose eagle as your emblem. Accountancy and auditing are not inventions of the recent past or importations from the West. India has had a great tradition of codifying the principles of accountancy and audit much before the West could think of them. You may be aware of the fact that there are four fundamental features that distinguish the Indian philosophical thought from the others. These four are: number one, the belief in the existence of God; number two, the understanding of the transient nature of the universe; number three, the belief in the theory of karma; and number four, the belief in the attainment of moksha or liberation. Out of these four, the theory of karma is nothing but a philosophical exposition of perhaps by double entry system. But there is one essential difference between the double entry system of accounting and the law of karma. As per the law of karma, the account need not necessarily tally, and nature does not allow us to arrive at the net balance of the good and bad karma of individuals, whereas the principle of double accounting allows for adjustments. According to Hindu mythology, the earliest chartered accountant, who was the most trustworthy chartered accountant, was Chitragupta. He is supposed to keep an account of all acts of merit and sin committed by the individuals and to submit an audit report on the date of the final judgment. If only he was following the system of double entry accounting, people would go either to hell or heaven, depending upon the net balance, positive or negative, after the adjustment of the total amount of sins against the total amount of merits. But Chitragupta's system of accounting is completely different. According to his system, every human being must reap the benefits of all the good and bad karma, and his system does not permit adjustments or appropriation of one against the other and the calculation of the net balance. Therefore, every human being should invariably enjoy the pleasures of heaven for all the good deeds and suffer the ordeals of hell for all the bad deeds committed during his lifetime. If you trace the history of evolution of the system of accounting and auditing, one would find that there could have been no proper system of accounting until the invention of the coin or the currency. But even before the invention of coins and currency as negotiable instruments, there must have been some system followed by the king and the administrators for the purpose of collecting taxes and the revenue. The revenue was collected of the total yield from the land. Therefore, to begin with, accountants were only public accountants, since it was primarily the duty of the king to collect those taxes, keep them in the treasury, and spend them. But after private initiatives gained ground both in the agricultural and other sectors, such as excavation of mines for gold and silver, development of industries by artisans, even before the advent of the Industrial Revolution, the heads or kartas of joint families had to have a proper system of accounting. Though the karta was in absolute control and had no obligation to account for the income and expenditure to his family, a kind of moral necessity obliged them to have in place some system of accounting. When two or more persons entered into joint ventures in their crafts, they became obliged to each other. This perhaps led to the development of a more scientific method of accounting. Interestingly, one of the earliest Smritis, namely Narada Smriti, speaks about partnerships. You may be aware of the fact that traditionally there were 14 branches of learning, Chaturdasa Vidya, according to ancient Indian texts. They were comprised of the four Vedas, six Angas, Shadangas, and the four Upangas. The last of the Upanga is the Dharma Shastras. These Dharma Shastras are contained in Smritis expounded by 18 sages. One of those sages was Manu. It appears that Manu composed 100,000 verses, that is 1 lakh shlokas, divided into 1,080 chapters. He handed over the same to Narada, who abridged them to 12,000 verses and handed them over to Markandeya. Markandeya in turn condensed them into 8,000 shlokas and gave it to Sumati, the son of Bhrigu, who reduced it further to 4,000 shlokas. What was ultimately given is an abridged version of Manusmriti by Sumati. Narada Smriti discusses about 18 titles of law. They are law of debt, law of deposits, law of partnerships, law of resumption of gift, law relating to breach of contract of service, law relating to non-payment of wages, law relating to sales effected by a person other than the rightful owner, law relating to non-delivery of a sold chattel, law relating to rescission of purchase, law relating to transgression of a contract, law relating to boundary disputes, law relating to mutual duties of husband and wife, the law of inheritance, the law relating to heinous crimes, the law relating to abuse, the law relating to games, and the law relating to miscellaneous subjects not covered in the above list. Thus, it appears that the law of partnership is one of the 18 titles on which definite prescriptions were made thousands of years ago by Manu. Some of the rules laid down by Manu indicate that there must have been a proper system of accounting and auditing, as otherwise the implementation of the rules laid down by Manu could not have been possible. In chapter 3 of the Smriti, the following rules relating to partnership are laid down. Rule number 1, where several partners are jointly carrying on business for the purpose of gain, the contribution of funds towards the common stock of the association forms the basis of their undertakings. Therefore, let each other contribute his proper share. Rule number 2, the loss, expenses, and the profit of each partner are either equal to those of other partners or exceed them or remain below them according as his share. Rule number 3, the stores, the food, the charges for tolls and the like, the loss, the freight, and the expense of keeping valuables must be duly paid for by each of the several partners in accordance with the terms of their agreements. These were the rules formulated by Manu. Similarly, Brihaspati in his Smriti lays down certain rules. Rule number one, as an equal, smaller or larger share of the joint stock contributed by a partner, he must get it in the same proportion after defraying charges, labor and the profit to be distributed. Rule number two, of those who lend jointly gold, grain, liquids, condiments and the like, the gain shall be equal to their respective share of the joint expenditure, whether equal, more or less. Whatever property one partner may give or lend, authorized by many, or whatever contract he may cause to have executed, all that is done by all. These are some of the rules that Smritis have laid down for partnership and the contribution of partners and the shares that they are entitled to. Therefore, this necessarily involved a system of accounting and audit. Apart from Smritis, Kautilya's Arthashastras also throws light upon the principles of accounting and auditing. Arthashastra is easily about 2000 to 2300 years old, since historians place Kautilya either at 350 BC or 150 AD. It lays down elaborate rules relating to audit and accounts. In book number 5, Kautilya deals with budgeted accounts and audit. He has classified income into three categories. Kautilya has classified income into three categories. They are current income, transferred income, and miscellaneous income. Miscellaneous income is again divided into three categories, namely, one, recovery of debts and dues which were written off earlier. Number two, deductions from anticipated expenditure that are to be treated actually as income. For example, work abandoned before completion. And number three, income due to profit on sales. Kautilya shows actual expenditure under three headings. Number one, budgeted day-to-day expenditure. Number two, non-budgeted day-to-day expenditure. And number three, foreseen periodic expenditure. In book two, Kautilya mentions the items of revenue to be included on the receipts side and the items of expenditure to be included on. Kautilya does not talk about fudging of accounts, window dressing, or reverse engineering in the preparation of the statement of affairs. The duties and responsibilities of accounts officers are also mentioned in chapter 7 of book 2 of Kautilya as follows. He says, accounts officers shall present themselves for audit at the appointed time, bringing with them their account books and the income to be remitted to the treasury. They must be ready for audit when the audit officer calls him. He shall not lie about the accounts when questioned during audit. He shall not try to interpolate an omitted entry as if it was forgotten inadvertently. Failure to conform to any of the above regulations was made by Kautilya a punishable offense. In case a discrepancy is discovered during audit, what is to be done is also provided by Kautilya. He says, the official concerned shall pay a penalty if the discrepancy has the effect of either showing a higher actual income of a lower actual or a lower actual expenditure, in both cases the state being the loser. The official shall keep the difference for himself when a lesser amount than the one shown by the official is actually due to the state. There is an interesting passage in Kautilya which indicates the balance to be adopted by the administrators, namely the civil servants. But it is so apt even for the present day corporate governance. It reads as follows. I quote, "He who causes loss of revenue eats the king's wealth. He who produces double the anticipated revenue eats up the country. He who spends all the revenue without bringing any profit eats up the labor of workmen." I unquote. According to Kautilya, in a well-organized state, there will be a chief comptroller and auditor. He will be responsible for the construction and the maintenance of a record office built facing north or east, with separate seats for accountants and a well-organized for accounts. The comptroller and auditor general, according to Kautilya, is required to maintain the following records. Number one, a consolidated account book showing for each department the nature of its activity and the total income received from it. In the case of manufacturing establishments, he must maintain a stock register showing the raw materials bought or received, the quantities consumed in manufacturing, the discrepancies due to use of different weights and measures, and changes due to mixing of materials. He should also maintain a manufacturing cost register showing expenditure on the labor employed and the wages paid. And insofar as the servants of the crown are concerned, he must also maintain a register which contains details about all the grants, titles to land, gifts, land allotted for use, etc. There must be a separate register maintained by the comptroller and auditor general for the royal household, and this register should record the gifts of jewelry and land, special allowances, and the provisions made against sudden calamities such as emergency funds. There must be a separate register for foreign affairs, payments and registers in war with allies as well as enemies are supposed to be entered in such a register. The closing day for the accounting year, according to Kautilya, shall be the full moon day of the month of Ashada. It must be June, July. The year consisting of 354 days according to the lunar calendar, with a separate book for intercalary month. The chief comptroller and auditor, according to Kautilya, should compile for every department the estimated revenue, the actual revenue, outstanding revenue, income, expenditure, and balance. He must also compile reports on the presentation of accounts by other officials and a description of the activities of the government for the period under review. In the tax regime that prevailed in ancient India, there was also a practice of granting tax holidays. The concept of granting tax holidays is not something new. It has prevailed over centuries in this country, but it was of a different nature. An interesting illustration of this could be found in the Tamil version of the Ramayana. In the Tamil version of the Ramayana, authored by Kamban, there is a reference to King Dasharatha granting a tax holiday. What was the occasion? He lived without begetting a child for thousands of years, and ultimately he gets four children. Immediately upon being informed of the birth of four children, King Dasharatha takes a holy dip in the river. He visits the newly born babies and he immediately orders a tax holiday for 7 years. Kambaramayana says, இறை தவிர்ந்திடுக பார் யாண்டு ஓர் ஏழ் நிதி நிறைதரு சாலை தாழ் நீக்கி யாவையும் முறைகட வறியவர் முகந்து கொள்க என அரை பறை என்றனன் அரசர் கோமகன். தி மீனிங் ஆஃப் தி ஃப்ரேஸ் இறை தவிர்ந்திடுக பார் யாண்டு ஓர் ஏழ் ஈஸ் தட் தி ஸ்டே தட் தி ஸ்டேட்ஸ் தட் கம் அண்டர் ஹிஸ் கண்ட்ரோல் அண்ட் ஹிஸ் ஓன் சப்ஜெக்ட்ஸ் ஆர் எக்ஸம்ட் ஃப்ரம் பேமெண்ட் ஆஃப் டாக்ஸ் ஃபார் 7 years. Therefore, your profession, according to me, has a lot to inherit from our glorious past. The reason why I started off under the caption Professional Ethics from Manu is that you have inherited a great tradition, and all of you should first know about that tradition, which alone can provide you a clue as to the ethical values that you could adopt. The fundamental difference between the system that prevailed in our country and the one that prevailed elsewhere at all times is this. The system that prevailed in India recognized the importance of wealth, artha, but cautioned that it should be acquired only through dharma, religious means, righteous means. It is only with the wealth so accumulated that one has to fulfill all the desires, namely kama of his life. Then the path to moksha, liberation, is smooth. This is what our scriptures used to call as purushartas, dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. The duty of a chartered accountant is to ensure that his clients earn artha to dharma. This, in substance, is the ethical standard to be adopted by a chartered accountant. Dear friends, today there is no dearth of talent in every profession, be it the profession of law, medicine, or chartered accountancy. But unfortunately, there is a dearth of ethical values. What stimulates ethical practices in personal life or professional life or business venture is a wrong notion that your status and happiness in life is measured only by your success. The belief that through righteous means one cannot achieve success is now gaining ground, which is the most unfortunate thing that has happened in this country. But for those who think so, here is a piece of interesting information. This is something that happened in the 1920s. Some of the world's most successful financiers met in 1923 at the Edgewater Beach Hotel in Chicago. Happened in 1923. Present were the president of the largest independent steel company, the president of the largest utility company, the greatest wheat speculator, the president of the New York Stock Exchange, a member of the cabinet of the president of the United States, the greatest bear on Wall Street, the president of the Bank of International Settlements, and the head of the world's greatest monopoly. All of them were present in a suite in the Edgewater Beach Hotel in 1923. These 8 men together controlled more wealth than the US Treasury. Success stories of these men had featured in magazines and journals for many years. But all of them had something in common towards the end of their lives. Charles Schwab, president of the steel company, lived the last years of his life on borrowed money and died a broken man. Arthur Cutten, the greatest speculator, died abroad, insolvent. Richard Whitney, president of the New York Stock Exchange, served a term in Sing Sing prison. Albert Fall, member of the president's cabinet, was pardoned from prison to die at home. Jesse Livermore, the greatest bear on Wall Street. Leon Fraser, president of the Bank of International Settlements, and Ivan Kruger, head of the world's largest monopoly, all committed suicide. Thus, 7 out of those 8 successful men ended their lives in tragedy and sorrow. The great epic Mahabharata gives us the example of Sahadeva, the youngest of the Pandavas, for practicing the highest degree of professional ethics. Sahadeva was, apart from being a great warrior, a renowned astrologer too. After Lord Krishna's mission for peace failed, the writing on the wall was clear that war was inevitable. When Pandavas and Kauravas started making preparations for war, Duryodhana was advised to make a human sacrifice at a very auspicious time in the battlefield so as to ensure success in the war. When the question of fixing the auspicious time arose, since Sahadeva was considered to be the greatest astrologer at that time, but he was not merely in the opposite camp, but he was actually an opponent by himself. But Duryodhana went straight to Sahadeva and asked him to suggest an auspicious time. In spite of a warning by Lord Krishna and persuasion by his other brothers, Sahadeva suggested to Duryodhana the most auspicious time for him to perform this sacrifice so that Duryodhana could win the war and the Pandavas could be destroyed. When confronted by Lord Krishna and his own brothers, Sahadeva said that no professional shall fail the confidence reposed by the person consulting him. Even at the risk of losing his kith and kin and his own life, Sahadeva practiced the highest degree of professional ethics. Dear friends, there is an interesting story about the difference between heaven and hell. A businessman died and he was produced before God for final judgment. The greatest and the noblest accountant of all times, namely Chitragupta, who was never in the habit of manipulating or window dressing the balance sheets of individuals, read out the good and bad deeds of the businessman. God ordained him to hell for a few months and to heaven for a few months. When this businessman wanted to know the difference between the two, he was taken on a conducted tour to both the places. Around meal time, lunch or so, this businessman entered the hell where he found the occupants thin. Some angels arrived there and placed large platters of delicious food at the table. But before anyone was seated, another angel came along and strapped a long iron spoon to each other's arm. The long handle of the spoon was fastened to the wrists and biceps, making it impossible to bend the arm. As a result, no one was able to lift the spoon to his mouth. The messengers of God informed the businessman that this was the daily routine in hell, where all of them will have delicious food in front of them, but no one will be able to eat it because they can't fold their hands and take the spoon to their mouth. Then the businessman was taken to heaven. He was surprised to find that those in heaven were well fed and healthy. Dinner was already on the table, and an angel had just finished strapping the long iron spoons to the arms of the diners. Whatever happened in hell also happened in heaven. But then something very strange happened. Each person in heaven dipped his spoon into the food, took the food, and fed the man seated across him. Since everyone was feeding the other, all of them all of them got fed and everyone enjoyed the delicacies. It was then that the businessman understood the difference between heaven and hell. Dear friends, the downfall of standards in every profession occurred when we replaced our system based on human values with a system based on monetary value. I think as chartered accountants, you may have to remember a poem which one of my chartered accountant friends forwarded to me. I do not know who its author is, but it's a poem worth quoting before I conclude my speech. The poem goes as follows. Our birth is our opening balance. Our death is our closing balance. Our prejudiced views are our liabilities. Our creative ideas are our assets. Our heart is our current asset. Our soul is the fixed asset. Our brain is our fixed deposit. Our thinking is our current account. Our achievements are our capital, or our stock in trade. Friends are our general reserves. Values and behavior are our goodwill. Patience is our interest earned. Love is our dividend. Children are our bonus issues. Education is brands and patents. Knowledge is our investment. Experience is our premium account. Therefore, the aim should be to tally the balance sheet accurately. The goal should be to get the Best Presented Accounts Award ultimately before Chitragupta. So with these few words, I take this opportunity to thank the office bearers of the SIRC of ICAI for having given me this opportunity to share a few thoughts on the topic professional ethics. Thank you very much.
You're on mute, Chairman. You're on mute.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Ramasubramanian sir. In fact, in Tamil, there is an old saying that Varlaru Mukhyam Amaichire that keeps getting told. But that was on the lighter side. But you did touch upon the history and the traditions and how much things are there which we should take to see that we kind of follow the ethics in today's life. And all those things that have been told kind of stand relevant very today. Before I request Abhishek to propose the vote of thanks, I would like to thank one more person, advocate and CA K. Ravi, past chairman of SIRC, who was kind enough to see that we are able to get the date and time of Justice V. Ramasubramanian ji. Sir, we are thankful to you and we thank for all the support you kind of provide for SIRC. Abhishek, over to you to propose the vote of thanks.
Just a moment, Abhishek, one moment.
Yeah.
When Honorable Justice V. Ramasubramanian sir spoke about Chitragupta, or Chitraguptan as we call, I don't know whether there is any temple other than the temple of Chitraguptan, which is in Kanchipuram.
Correct.
In the chartered accountants, all CA should go to Kanchipuram and pray to Chitraguptan, the first accountant in the universe of the world. And I don't know about any other temple, or probably that may be the only temple in India dedicated where the presiding deity of the temple is Chitraguptan only. Thank
you. That's right. But then by praying to him, he does not do anything, any favor. He only looks into your account, sir.
Let him look at it favorably.
Ravi sir, you would like to add anything, Ravi sir? You can unmute yourself, sir.
No, Ravi came just now. He came from Tirupati just now.
No, sir. He is there all the time. He was not on the screen, sir. He was there all the time, right from the beginning. Ravi sir?
He is not unmuted.
I have unmuted him, but we are not getting his audio actually.
No, he must unmute his system.
Ravi sir? No, I think there is some trouble with this connectivity, sir, actually. I also recognize the presence of C.A. Pannaraj, a regional council member from SARC, Sri Priya Kumar, who is past central council member and also SARC member. Abhishek, over to you to propose the well-deserved vote of thanks, please.
Thank you very much, Chairman. Justice V. Ramasubramaniam, sir, a truly wonderful lecture as always, and especially the examples that you drew from Manusmriti, and of course, how Chitragupta has influenced our accounting procedures and how his double entry bookkeeping was slightly different from our double entry bookkeeping. So I think you've really brought it up and tied it well together. We always say, bringing everything, all the facts, but tying it together is always the challenge. I think being your experience and how you've always tied things together for years together, now you're able to do it in such a beautiful manner. So thank you so much for your very valuable time, or invaluable time, I must say, and addressing our members, sir. I'm sure all our members will be hugely benefited by your time and your address. And we are eternally grateful to you, and you have continued the tradition of having one of the best speakers around for this memorial lecture. So thank you so much, sir. I also want to thank our Chairman SIRC, Dungachan Jain, beloved Central Council member, CA Rajendra Kumar, sir, CA K. Ravi, past chairman, was present but not audible, CA Pannaraj, sir, and other dignitaries who have joined us. Thank you so much, all. I wish you all good health, safety, take care, stay home, stay safe. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Before we conclude, let's rise for national anthem. Selva, you can just play the
best. पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल वंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे
Thank you all of you for joining, and Ramasubramaniam sir, we are looking forward to someday invite you to SARC and then to Madurai whenever things are conducive and suitable for you. Thank you.
Thank you.